Yes. Okay, so wait one more minute and then we'll start. So first question, can you hear me? And if one or two people can say yes, type yes or put a thumbs up. Thanks, Francis. Okay, so I have at least two people can hear me. Yeah, three. Well, great. Okay, so that means that we are good to go. Let's see, 32 participants. That is slight dip from Monday, but reasonable. So I suggest we start, and then the rest of the people can catch up. Francis, if you can keep an eye on the announcement, maybe there's other people that can't get in, and you can help them with the password. All right, that means that we're going to start. Welcome to this lecture. This is the third lecture of ICT development. It's going to be slightly different than the first two, of course, because we keep innovating now with every lecture. I'm just going to share my screen. Yes, so hopefully you should now all be able to see my PowerPoint presentation. The one thing that I wanted to do today is to allow for a little bit more interactivity, so to also make it a bit valuable that you actually show up here. I have some Mentimeter questions. So that's a website you can go there on your mobile phone or on your laptop and answer some questions that it will be spread out throughout the presentation. So we'll see how well that works. Okay, and as with last time, this lecture is being recorded. So I'll put the entire recording in a closed environment on Canvas. But still, if you are not willing to be recorded, or then you can shut off your camera or your mic and/or your microphone. So that's perfectly fine. I think most of you, actually all of you, do that already. That's fine. And at the end of the lecture, I have opportunity for asking the questions to also through Mentimeter. If there are questions so far, then also try to use the chat, and maybe others can answer them. I'm just trying to see. Yes, I have the chat open now here. I'll try to keep a sort of eye on that. All right. Without further ado, let's start. So today's lecture will be about human-computer interaction for development, and it sort of also leads into assignment one and explains why we are using the technologies and the modalities that we're using. So we'll start with sort of a general introduction in what HCI for development is, and then specifically also look at the idea of cross-cultural human-computer interaction, which is a research field within human-computer interaction. So that should take about 15 minutes. And then we'll start talking about specific interface solutions for dealing with low-literate users, which is one of the grand challenges that you read about in Melissa Ho's article. So we'll look at two modalities specifically. And then typically, I would also have in this lecture an explanation about building voice applications, voice XML, and Foxio Evolution. And now I did a pre-recording of that, so those can already be found in the assignment one module. So you're asked to look at those as preparation for Wednesday's practical. So I won't be going into detail here today, but just sort of I give you one or two slides about that. Okay, sorry about that. Right, okay, so you've been looking at this paper by Melissa Ho about human-computer interaction for development. And there's a few takeaways from this. One is that actually this is within the research field of ICT for development, one of the more established fields, right? So compute, like we discussed on Monday, computer science for development is not a huge field. It's a bit, let's say, most of the contributions towards ICT for development come from economics or sociology or development science. Not so much from computer science, even though it's there, as we argue. But for HCI, that's slightly different because for HCI, there has been a lot of people that are, a lot of researchers that are interested in how humans interact with machines or applications. And of course, if you have different types of users, then that's an interesting interesting field to study. So HCI for development starts with the question, what is HCI? And I assume that a lot of you either did a course in HCI or have some idea of what it is. It's really about this, the study of how computer systems can be designed in such a way that they can better interact with humans, but also the study of how humans actually interact with systems and the different ways that they are doing this. So it's one of the core computer science topics. And as such, it's what we're doing here. So really this idea of development informatics from the computer science perspective, again, like we discussed in the first lecture. All right, so what Melissa Ho, how she defines it is that HCI, the goal is to study how interactive products, applications, and systems can be appropriately designed to both address the needs of the users in developing regions and to cope with the different infrastructural context, right? So it's sort of we are in the domain of the development regions where we have both users that are different and we have both contexts that are different. And now we need to know how do we now redesign or redesign interactive applications, right? So, and that requires some study, some theory, and also some practice to make sure that this works out. So that's not all, because she also says, well, it's about applying the understanding. So it's not just about learning, but actually applying it and then build these ICTs, right? So it's also a very practical thing. That's both things we'll be doing in the course as well. And it might be that there's actually new types of technology needed, right? So in a lot of HCI results in new types of interfaces or in new types of ways in which people interact with systems. And here that could be the case as well. So it might be the case that we need to shape a new or more appropriate forms of ICTs. And then finally, also the blue, it says that we are looking at specific methodologies of doing this, right? Because we need to understand users even more than we do normally, because these users might be culturally but also geographically more distant from us. And therefore, we need appropriate methods that are able to bridge this gap more easily. So we need to have to build these human-centered approaches. And all of these things we'll have a look at in the rest of these slides. Then I said also that HCI for development is both a research and a practice, as is ICT for development that we discussed last time. So she says, compared to other fields of HCI, HCI for development has this risk of conflating research activity and development practice, right? So it's very important that you are aware as a researcher of when you're doing research, you're trying to gain knowledge, or when your goal is to do development. And sometimes these things happen at the same time. And sometimes it's either one or the other. And as a human-computer interaction researcher, you might have the challenge of identifying which activities lead to what type of results. Also one of the papers that are referenced is this paper by Hugo, which is really about how culture influences HCI design. So what's mentioned there is this, that is actually quite complex thing. So why are these users different? Well, because the culture might be different, because the economy might be different, but also the technological innovations or the resource constraints might be of influence on how HCI research is done and also how solutions are designed. So HCI for D is very closely related, but not the same as cross-cultural HCI. So cross-cultural HCI is the study of human-computer interactions, or HCI, across different cultural differences. So here the idea is we have a group of users on one end of the planet that interacts with systems in this way, and then we have another group of humans on our side of the planet that interact with systems in another way. And the differences are assumed to be a difference of culture, mostly, right? That's a very rich research field. Why? Because it's actually economically very interesting to be able to sell your interactive product to everybody on the planet rather than your specific user group in the Netherlands or in the US. Right, so that's what big companies do. Take, for example, Microsoft. Anytime they build a big user-facing system, let's say Word or PowerPoint, they are looking at, first of all, internationalization. So how do we make this locally designed product internationally viable? So what elements are specific to the culture that we've been designing it in and that we can elevate to an international level? And then localization. So how do we make it locally usable? And the most obvious local influence is, of course, language. So typically, if you talk about localization, you talk about translating software into a language. That's let's say the most obvious type of localization. Internationalization means that the software that I designed, let's say I built software for local radio stations in the Netherlands, right? So I have a beautiful software package and it's completely designed in Dutch. Now, if I want to do internationalization, what I do is I identify all the parts in which there's Dutch text and I make sure that I annotate them some way and that I can just make one file that I put all the translations in so that I can make a localized version in Spain or in the US quite easily, right? So internationalization is up and then localization is down. That's basically how you do it. They have these horrible abbreviations, I18, I10N, which are sort of, tells you that apparently there's marketeers that are looking at this as well. And this is something that's big business, right? Because again, you want to be able to sell your product to as many people as possible. Also mentioned by Ho in the article is this idea of communitization, which is sort of even localizing it further to very specific communities that might have their specific context. So in ICT for development perspective, you really want to look at maybe even a smaller granularity than just the national language. All right, so this is an example. It's not just language, but typically language is the first thing. So here we see on the top right, we see an example of some marketplace, Rakuten, in English and the Japanese version, sorry. So you actually see that it's not just translated piece of interface, but it's actually completely redesigned because this matches more the expectations apparently of the Japanese user versus the English user, right? So other than just doing translation, you can think about, well, obvious things are date formats, 12 versus 24 hour, color sensitivities might be culturally defined. Of course, currencies are very important, but often forgotten, and we made one of those mistakes ourselves. Phone numbers are different, holidays are different, right? So if you have your big Christmas holiday blowout, and you do it in a country that does not really do anything with Christmas, then that's not a sensible localization. Right, geographic examples could be irrelevant for some people, but also let's say the layout, as you can see here, can be completely different. So really localization of websites or tools, when done right, really is done locally often, but also includes all these different factors. And if you do it right, you just get more users, more happy users on your platform. So that sounds like it's just a bunch of just practical insights, but actually there's also some theory behind this. So you know, culture is this vague concept, right? So what is culture and how do we know what culture I'm a part of? I think sociologists or social psychologists are the first to tell you that, yes, this is very vague, but also we can try to quantify it. And I think one of the most famous people who have attempted this is Geert Hofstede. He's actually a Dutch social scientist who came up with these cultural dimensions. And they're a very famous way of categorizing culture. What he done is he's identified a number of factors, I think initially five, I think now there are six or seven, that determine your culture in some way. So these include power distance, how close you are to the powers that are hierarchically above you, uncertainty avoidance, how likely you are to take risks, how individual or collectivist your culture is, masculinity versus femininity, and long-term orientation versus short-term orientation. So this is the first part where I thought it would be nice to get some interactivity going. Also for me to sort of get a feeling about the diversity that's in the group here. So if you would go to menti.com and then enter the following code 976433, Just wanted to get some initial input. And this is really mostly to test whether this interactivity is working. So I give you a few minutes to enter this. We should get roughly things you get. 30-ish we should get, right? Right, I think one of the nice things about this course is that we often get, because it's a master course, but also because it should have an appeal to people with different backgrounds, we get people with lots of different cultural backgrounds. So let's see if that's actually true. So yes, it's also obvious that the largest part is still Dutch. And keep your, when you open the Mentimeter, keep that site open because more questions will pop up. So then you don't have to enter the code every time. This is really just to get started. There's one hidden Ghanaian person. We know who it is. It's Francis. Anna, you're a Brazilian. Did you enter Brazilian or Dutch as your cultural background?
Brazilian.
Very good. Yes, and of course I don't. So it's a bit unclear already, right? So what is your nationality, your culture, or is the culture that you associate with? And how is that for people with a migration background? So of course this is all very unclear and contentious. But this gives you an idea that at least we have a slightly diverse group. It's not just one big Dutch blob. So let's have a quick look at the type of questions that people like Geert Hofstede ask their participants to sort of get an idea about how this is measured, right? Because I understand this sounds very vague. How can you actually measure culture? But this is the type of questions that they use. So on this next question, you can drag a slider and answer three questions. So one question is about whether you are more or less comfortable with deferring to a greater authority. Right, so if you are not comfortable with deferring activities or decisions to a greater authority, you say you strongly disagree. And if you are, you do strongly agree. So that's about power distance. The second one is, I believe more in conforming to community values than in being personally responsible for my own success and achievement. So if you completely disagree, then you are more of an individualist as a person. And if you more agree, then you're more of a collectivist. And the third one is about uncertainty avoidance, right? Do you conform more to, do you have strong need to keep your life organized and planned? Or do you feel more at home in freewheeling, spontaneous, or even chaotic situations? So it's a bit, sometimes a bit unclear with what way the question is phrased, but if you can enter. Nonetheless, we can at least see what the average culture of the ICT4D student is, right? Because we don't do this per nationality, because I also think that wouldn't be very anonymous. But if you do this, we can get some sort of average. And these are questions from an actual questionnaire that was used to measure these things. So you can actually, you can sort of measure these for your own project and get some understanding of each of these different factors for your user group. It has been extensively studied and it's quite robust, right? So it's of course individually you might be the one collectivist in a very individualist society or vice versa, but this at least gives you some indication of the user group that you're working. Right, so here we could say that we are in the middle with respect to power distance. So right, so everybody's relatively okay with deferring stuff to hierarchies or relatively okay with doing it themselves. I would say that we are more or less individualist in this side, and I think that this correlates well with the Dutch. Mindset. But we have people that also go for the other ends of the spectrum, right? And then again, in the middle, we have this uncertainty avoidance factor. Right? Okay, so thank you for indulging, and there will be a few more questions later on in the presentation. So these are numbers that were sort of from big studies on more than 27 people. Of course, then they become more valid. And you can actually see that this is per country. You can have these identifications of the level of, for example, uncertainty avoidance in Argentina versus Australia, or Greece versus Hong Kong. So if we, for example, look at Brazil, then we can see that this is a very, I would say, collectivist society, yeah, rather than when compared to Canada, for example. Right. So, and of course, you might not agree as a person, but this is sort of from a large study. Right. So this is the way that these things are measured, and that now we know the culture of your users in some way, so it's quantified. And now the question is, of course, how do we design for these things? So this is an example, right? So this is the match.com, which was a matchmaking service. And you can see how it's differently designed for Italy versus Venezuela. And this, for example, is more about collectivist versus individual. So one of the design guides for individualist societies is that you're focusing more on the individual, right? So it's, you're not wowed by lots of crowds of people, for example. And this works a bit, right? So you're more engaged with this website. Another example would be that cultures in which you have this high tendency to defer to a higher hierarchical construct, they tend to have more, let's say, shields and flags of government institutions on websites, right? And, you know, me as a Dutch person, I personally would not be very convinced if the Dutch government says this is a great product that I would then want to buy the product, right? But in other cultures, that might be more prevalent. Again, all of this is sort of marginally better, right? So it doesn't say that it would never work, this website in Italy. But still, if you want more people to buy this your stuff as a marketeer, this is really interesting and valuable information, this cultural dimension. So you can actually see that designing interfaces for always depends on your users, and in this case, depends on the culture of your users. And you can measure that to some extent. So that's how they are related. I think one important thing to mention is that in this cross-cultural HCI, which is a big research field or a big field of practice, the international development is not a goal in and of itself. It's really about selling more product, right? Or by making the product more accessible. So it's sort of, they do similar things, but they're never, you know, the same goal. Okay, so another thing that Melissa Ho also mentioned is this idea of coming up with new human-centered methodologies for doing HCI. And often these are very user-centered methodology. So what you often see in HCI for development is that there's even more emphasis on these user-centric design cycles, for example. And it also matches the more participatory approaches to doing development as a whole, right? So participatory is a sort of a magic word in international development, where you don't want to sort of say, oh, we know what you want, here it is. But you want to sort of develop development solutions together with the people about that are actually influenced by these or affected by these solutions. And user-centric design basically says the same thing, but for designing systems. There's all kinds of more living labs-like methodologies, which really say you have to be in some location as a designer to be able to identify the challenges for which your solutions might work, and then also design them. So this Living Labs actually originates in the Netherlands. Philips actually was one of the first companies to do this, where really you have to be in someone's living room to be able to know that, oh, they're constantly annoyed by the fact that they have to turn on the lights with a physical switch. So now we develop an application that allows them to say the words lights on, something like that. But then for development situation, similar things. Right, so which brings it very close to this idea of action research, and here we get to this idea of conflating practice and research, that for HCI researchers, it's, you know, very important that you're aware of your own role in the process of developing, and whether you're helping by developing new solutions, or researching new ways of doing this, and you should be aware of this, right? So that's I think one important thing that she says. And then so finally, to close with the grand challenges that Melissa Hall identified. So they're here, so these six challenges, and the ones that are in boldface are the ones that we at least address a little bit in course, right? So we try to problematize it, so we try to also identify research challenges. I think that's important, and also we ask you to constantly do that. The idea is to reuse knowledge from HCI for development to avoid reinventing the wheel, so to sort of reuse existing studies about, for example, the relation between cultural features and design. We have the support of ecosystem around affordable computing. So that's more the hardware, low resource hardware lecture that we'll do next Monday. And then this idea of user interfaces for illiterate and semi-literate. So that's one of the big challenges, because that's a very difficult group to connect successfully to in developing a system. And then the other two, a clear development success story. Of course, you will be developing applications, but to be honest, we don't expect them to get out of the pilot phase within the course of this this course. And the same, right, what we're doing here is really about building HCI capacity or ICT4D capacity here in the Netherlands. And we have this course ICT for development in the field, where really we want to also build more capacity over there. But that's not really something that can be done within the context of this course. So we try to address at least some of the challenges that Melissa Ho identified. And for the next few slides, we'll look more at these user interfaces for illiterate and semi-literate users. If there are any questions or any remarks, then now the quick break, and otherwise I'll take a little sip of water, and then we continue. No, then I'll continue for I think roughly 10-15 minutes, and then I'll take a little break after that. And then, like I said, I plan to have this wrapped up in an hour or so, so that you can go back to watching the video. Okay, so what's the problem these interfaces for low literate users? So one thing that we can approach, how we can approach this, is by looking at the type of devices that are actually being used. So this is some data that we got from already 2008, so it's a bit old. But similar figures can be made for current more current data. So this is about the type of applications that people own, right? So we see here that there's a big percentage in Togo, Nigeria, Senegal, and Ghana that own televisions. And we see actually that most people own radios, but access to computers and internet is actually quite quite low. And here we see mobile phone coming up. And of course, this is now much higher in 2020. And that's one of the reasons why we see that people don't use the web a lot, right? Because they don't have access to the web. So that's one way, one problem that we might have to solve if we want to build information systems for low literate users. Okay, so this rise of the mobile phone is something that has really, really grown. We actually now have more individuals telephone subscriptions in Africa than there are inhabitants of Africa. And I'm not sure about other parts in the world, but probably something similar is that there's now more SIM cards around than people, which means that sometimes people have more than one mobile phone or even multiple SIM cards. It's quite usual that people have SIM cards for different providers, for example. But let's say the image that you see here on the bottom is something that's quite common. So people generally have access to mobile phones. In most of the areas where we have gone, it's either everybody has a phone or every family has a phone, or almost every family has a phone, right? So this is something that we can assume. There was a question actually asked last lecture. About can we assume that people have mobile phones? So in most of the regions that we have been talking about, specifically the ones for the use cases, yes, we can assume that safely. So that's nice. But what kind of mobile phones, right? And if you, I'm not sure how well you can see in the picture here, but if you look at those are not the mobile phones that, you know, that we have, these ones with basically the, you know, the fancy smartphones. But often these are what are called feature phones or basic phones. So phones that are, let's say, a bit older, have sometimes some limited capability, but mostly are just usable for calling and receiving text messages. So you see that that the percentage of basic phones plus feature phones, this is the right, a red bar and the green bar together, still is the majority of phones. One of the reasons is the cost, although that's going down quite fast. But another reason is battery usage. So if you have no access to electricity or no reliable electricity, it actually is much more useful to have a phone that runs much longer. And the third reason is that if you are dealing with illiterate or low literate users, then there's really no need to have all kinds of fancy applications that you cannot effectively use as a user. So there's multiple reasons why this is happening. Okay, so quick question that I see here is, why was West Africa chosen as a region for this kind of research for ICT for development? It's a sort of historically region that a number of projects running. We do also have one of the use cases is in rural Malaysia. So that's also just because we have people there. We have some examples from South America as well, and also Southeastern Asia. But most of the stuff we do has been also with collaborations like the university where Francis is working. So some of the things that I'm saying are true for other parts in the world. The rise of mobile phone is pretty global. But for example, the way that mobile phones are distributed among men and women might be very different from one culture to the other. So it's a very good question. Thanks. Okay, so back to the slide. So we have these mobile phones, so that's nice. How can we now communicate with these users? So one way that we can actually communicate with the users is through with mobile phone, given that they don't have smartphones, is by using SMS. And there's actually quite a lot of SMS services in ICT for development that are used. So this is an example, Frontline SMS, which is a well-known one. Where all kinds of medical information is being distributed to users in the field, and then doctors or medical professionals can actually get information from the field, for example, by doing surveys. So people get a survey in a mobile phone, and then doctors can, for example, trace outbreaks of diseases, right? Very relevant now. Actually, I know of one or two COVID-related cases where they're trying to do this monitoring with SMS. But also give status updates and maybe even do a limited diagnosis over SMS. So that's one. And this is another one. Text2Change is actually an Amsterdam-based company that is doing this. So, for example, this is about getting all kinds of, for companies to do all kinds of surveys in the field. So this is for NGOs. So also medical clients, but also, for example, election monitoring is done a lot. Okay, so that's nice, but now we're still not there, because for SMS you have to be able to read and write, right? So we're still not tackling this low literate and semi-literate users. We're tackling people with the mobile phone, so we're looking at the devices that they have, but we're not looking at difficulties with actually writing and reading messages. So we have seen that this is one of the grand challenges. And it's also very prevalent among the rural poor. So you see that actually a lot of ICT for development projects, they stay within cities. And that's because often people are more able to read and write, or read and write easy languages. And really the hard cases are the ones that need it most, you could argue, right? So these are people that are in rural areas that are often less educated because they're in agricultural communities. Their low literacy is very prevalent. So if you're not targeting, you know, the most difficult cases, you're actually helping the ones that need it less than the people that need it most. Right? And one of the ways of looking at this from a from a computer science perspective is by thinking, for example, about web accessibility, right? So if we're building stuff like the World Wide Web, then we build in all kinds of guidelines about how to make this web universally accessible. And there's actually, you know, W3C mandated guidelines that call for this accessibility to be a feature of any designed web application. And now we're basically building applications that are non-accessible for a large part of the world, which are these low-literate people. Okay, so then we do another quiz, and then after that we'll take a short break. This is just sort of to get an idea about literacy rates. So this you don't know, of course you can look it up, but I hope you don't. So just to get a quick idea about what you think the adult literacy rate in Zimbabwe is. So is it between 0 and 30%, 30 and 50, 50 and 70, or 70 and 100? So this is really to get a, get you remembering these numbers. Okay. So it's a bit perverse that we hope that one of the bars is winning, but it looks like there's a slight majority for the two lower lower cases. No, I'm not sure. Oh, I think I made a mistake in actually showing you the right answer. That might be just my mistake. Let me see if I can change it. So I leave you to vote for one more second, few more seconds. And then I'll quickly configure the other question so that you don't see the answer. Yes, I think it's now. Okay, thanks for voting. So the correct answer is answer D. So it's between 70 and 100%. Right, so this, sorry, this is a bit of a trick, but it's actually quite high. So the average literacy rate in Zimbabwe, I think, was around 91%. I will show you the number. Thank you, yeah, very, very well voted. So let's do one more to sort of get a slightly different view. So this is, what is the adult literacy rate in Mali? Okay, so yeah, so Zimbabwe was 93%. Yeah, so we have a slight correction. So rather than everybody going for the lowest one, people move a little bit more to the middle. Okay, so it's sort of, you think I tricked you in the first one and you don't think it's between 70 and 100. Very, very well thought out. I think I also might have shown a few people the right answer, but indeed the correct answer is between 0 and 30%. All right, so okay, so that's quite a big difference. And this is one, of course, of the big problems is that, and you're not to be blamed for that, that actually most people don't know anything about a region like Sub-Saharan Africa. I think it's basically one big country, right? And everything is roughly the same. And of course, you look deep in your heart, you know that that's not true, that there's probably large differences. Right. Sub-Saharan Africa, as we saw last time, is about, or the Sahel region is about the size of the United States and with much more cultural diversity. And we also see here that these numbers are really different. So if you look at these literacy rates, and these are from 2013, so they're not 100% accurate, but they're roughly in the same proportion. We actually see that Zimbabwe has done really well in its educational programs, and has considered very high literacy rate. So, right, so most of Western Europe is in this more than 97%, but Zimbabwe is quite quite close, and South Africa is the same. Right, and Mali is one of the worst countries. So that's really bad. So it's roughly 27%. I think it has it's approaching 30 now, but there's a lot of differences within countries, right? So in Mali, it's 27%, but that's in males in cities. Mali is currently 33%, thanks. Right, so it's now, there's large differences within this country. Right, so you can see here that okay, it matters where which country you're at, but these are this shows how much it might vary within the country. So this is for India. So India actually as a country is green, so somewhere between 70-80% again in 2013. But if you look at how it's distributed for males versus females, you can actually see that there are large differences. So if you look, for example, at the difference between rural female users in rural areas, it's 30%, and male participants in cities are 88%. So you can actually, so my takeaway is, you don't really know before investigating it. Who is your user group? Where do they live? And how is it distributed between different parts of your user base? Okay. So I'll just close with this one. And then also we are talking about low literacy rate, right? So, which is a very unclear definition. So. There are globally acknowledged definitions, but for example, the UNESCO has multiple levels, right? So in the Netherlands, for example, we have this 97% plus literacy rate, but there's a lot of people who are so-called functional illiterate, which means that they cannot read complex letters, for example, that are sent to them by municipalities. So even though technically your users might be able to read and write, it might mean that they are not able to read and write or process the type of information that you want to send them. So again, just blindly following these numbers is not always helpful. You have to really look at your user base and then the type of information that you send them. Okay. Thanks for now. We'll take a 4-minute break, 5-minute break. And then in the second half, we'll continue with actually developing solutions that should take roughly 15 minutes, so then we're maybe 20, so then we're done, let's say, at the 70-minute break. Yeah. So if you have any questions, please put them in the chat for now. You can also wait till the end, and otherwise I'll see you back in 5 minutes. Okay. Welcome back. I'm going to continue. All right. So I'll try to go a little bit faster through this. There's two more questions for you, so that should be okay. Okay, so we've looked at HCI for development as a research field, and we've looked specifically at developing solutions for low literate users, why that's a challenge. We'll look now at some solutions, right? So one way of connecting to low literate users is by using icon-based interfaces. So I'm not going to show you this video, but that's actually quite an interesting research in Heidi Mady from Microsoft, who has been looking at participatory design of icon-based interfaces for all kinds of applications. And specifically, this is in India, but similar research has been done in other places as well. Right, so icon-based interfaces are quite common. Actually, most cash machines in the Netherlands, or some of the cash machines actually, not all of them, had for low literate users have completely iconized interfaces. So this on the one, you have one. And if you go, for example, to airports, you see that you have these sort of icons that are combined in such a way that you know where, you know, where to put your box, your luggage, where to get it out. So there's even some grammars where you can actually combine different icons, because the nice thing is you don't have to be able to read or write, you just have to understand the images. It's also nice because they could actually be used on feature phones, right? So you don't have to have smartphones, even though you can have smartphone apps that use icons. You can also have on feature phones quick icons, for example, to show you these kind of things, right? So, okay, there's grain, there's 1 kilo grain, and then there's 250 francs CFA. And this looks like, oh, but you have to be able to read and write. And actually what we found, and also other people have found, is that even though some people might be technically illiterate, they are literate in some ways. For example, they can read numbers, or they can read things like kilo or CFA, which is the local currency in a lot of West African French-speaking countries. Right, because again, these people are farmers, so they do a lot of business and do a lot of deals, and they sell and buy produce. But actually, they're very, you know, familiar with using numbers in this way. So again, here, where, you know, sometimes you make the mistake one way around, where you say, "Oh, I expect that people cannot read and write," and then they can do more than you think, and also the other way around. So here you can have feature phone-based interfaces that use Java libraries, for example, to show images, and you can actually combine it with audio information and then help the user even more. So one big challenge is that icons are not culturally neutral, right? So icons are depending on culture. So, for example, this arrow for me means back. I don't remember who of you has Arabic as a nationality or a cultural background, but if your prime language is Arabic, which is written, of course, from right to left, then the back arrow in most interfaces in Arabic is actually the other way around, right? So this arrow already is very culturally specific. Well, and you can imagine that, you know, my house could look like this, but for a lot of people, this is not the shape of their house. And let alone what this thing might be, right? So there's all kinds of cultural assumptions that are used to make these icons usable. And now, of course, these icons are, you know, recognized because they've been used over and over. But people who for the first time encounter an application, they don't have this sort of experience with these icons. And so they need to be sort of self-explanatory, and often they are not, right? Another example is this one here on the top right, which is used in a medical application. And this means headache. Well, apparently it's very depending on your culture what you do when you have a headache, right? So if you have a headache in the Netherlands, let's say, right, what you do is you put your hands on your head and you look down because, ow, I am in pain, right? And then these arrows here, these things here are pain indicators. But for a lot of cultures, what people do is when they have a headache is they look up, right? And then this might be a different thing. And also the lightning bolts might not mean the same thing. This, for example, is the Dutch signal for icon for farmer, right? Or I could recognize this farmer. But the majority of farmers in the world do not look like this because they don't have a big tractor. They have atzes and other material, right? So yes, it's an angry person. Right, so and all kinds of other icons are of course very dependent on your cultural background and your experience with the interfaces or with the devices. So that's quite difficult. But nevertheless, it's being used. And what we are going to focus on, at least in the first two assignments here, is speech interfaces, which is really a very popular way of connecting to low literate people. Why? Because speech is, to a certain extent, the most natural human interface, user human computer interface, right? So it's the one, the thing that we use all the time to do information exchange with each other. So it's very natural, and it sort of is very close to what we are used to doing. So we have these voice interfaces that we'll be building. And now what's interesting is a lot of the things that you'll be learning is not just specific to ICT for development, but actually there's a lot of research and development into building effective voice systems. So think about, you know, your smartphone applications like Siri or the one that Android has. But also, for example, in car systems, right? So if you're driving, you can't use your hands to manipulate the system. But you can, for example, talk to your car, right? And then it might actually do things. So in a lot of situations, voice services are really helpful. Another reason why it's very interesting is that, so whereas some cultures are have a very written culture, some other cultures are not so much used to writing things down. For example, we've seen that a lot in the CARPA project, which is one of the use cases in Congo. So we have people that can read and write, but they say it's just not very natural for them to write these things down. If you have a problem, you tell it to someone, right? Or tell it to something, in this case, an application. So in some cases, it might be, even though people are technically able to do something, it might be very much more natural for them to communicate with the system using voice. And it depends on the type of system and the type of user. Okay, so we're talking about voice services, interactive voice response systems. These are usable on simple mobile phones, and the interaction goes either through voice or to what is called DTMF, which is the way you type in numbers, right? So press 2 to do X. I'm sort of giving a quick preview for the video that is in the assignment 1 module. Right, so you can have a quite complex voice menus where you can have choices, right? So you have real interaction with the user using this thing. So I'm sure everybody has used at some point interactive voice response system. Usually they're quite short, like this one, right? Where you get a team score, but they can get quite complex. So this is, again, apologize for the image. This is a very complex voice menu, a visualization of the voice menu for a service that is for banana farmers, developed in Sweden. So it's not for Swedish users. It's for, I think, for users in North Africa. But you can actually see that it's quite a complex system already. So you can do quite a lot of things. Right. So that's what we're going to do, and the other videos tell you more about this. One thing to keep in mind is it's not just about normal literacy or language literacy. But there's also the thing computer literacy, right? So we are all used to using computer systems on a daily basis. But for people who have never used something like a menu, right? To maneuver to something or to use search or to browse somewhere. These things are all not necessarily very natural. So if you use metaphors like that, it might not be completely immediately understood. And no, that doesn't matter in which modality, so whether you do that by voice or by icons or by some visual interface, right? And there's some research that says this, for example, that some cultures might be more familiar with hierarchical structuring of information, right? Some groups of users might be more familiar with specific kinds of metaphors, right? So the famous safe disk icon that you have everywhere is of course based on a physical medium that I hope that none of you that are watching here has ever physically actually had to use, right? So for me, this was the thing that I actually used. But now it's just the icon that is the safe icon, and people know that safe icon because it's a safe icon. Right? But for people who have never used it, why would they ever think that this is the icon for safe? And the same happens for voice things, right? So if you say something like, do you want to save your message? So is that something that is natural? Does it make sense in that context, or does it require some previous use of computer systems? So that's also something, if you're designing these things, to really take into account. All right. So a little word about languages, because we now talked about literature, but of course we have a multitude of languages, which is a challenge for specifically, not only for voice systems, but also for voice systems. So we have a quick question. How many languages are there in the world? Not sure if you saw the right answer. I thought I disabled it. So this is the amount of languages in the world. So how many do you think there are? So I'm still a bit of a Mentimeter noob, but I will be super good next time. All right, so let's get a few more answers. Yes, we have a few. Okay, so there's a definite clustering around a lot. Right, so the correct answer is indeed more than 2,000. Well done. So how many are there? So the answer is we don't really know. So this is actually quite difficult to answer. So it depends on how you count, where one language stops and a dialect begins, and if two languages are different, of course. So appending, and also we don't know all the languages. New languages keep being discovered. But the numbers range somewhere between 3,000 and, depending on the definition, 7,500, 8,000 sometimes. Right. So that's a lot. And you can actually see in the background of this image that in, for example, sub-Saharan Africa, there's a lot per square kilometer, whereas in Europe, it's less dense. The densest part is actually here in Papua New Guinea, where I think there's one number that says there's even 3,000 languages in Papua New Guinea alone. One theory is that because it's so hard to get from A to B, to get one to the village 1 kilometer down the road because of mountains and jungle, that people just don't talk to each other a lot, and then you get these separate languages. And the same happens in parts of sub-Saharan Africa, where the physical distance might be small, but just people don't get there a lot. One of the interesting side notes is that people in these areas tend to speak a lot of different languages, right? Because if you need to talk to your neighbor because you are visiting him or her, then you need to be able to talk different languages. So typically, you know, I always joke that in the Netherlands, we're always so proud that we speak, you know, maybe 3 languages. But if you talk to the average rural farmer in Mali, then he might speak 4 languages easily without being able to read and write. So that's sort of the right. And then you get to this interesting part. We are talking here about small or large languages. So a large language is one that has a significant population of speakers, and we all know the large languages. So that's English, that's German, that's Chinese, that's Portuguese, right, because of Brazil, but it's also Dutch. And that's maybe a bit more surprising for those that who know that there's only like a few million speakers, right? So we have the Netherlands with 70 million, then maybe the Belgians. I don't know how many speak Dutch as a language, but let's say that's, you know, with 30 million, you have all the people that speak Dutch in the world. But, you know, if you understand that we have 6,000 languages, then of course this is one of the biggest ones, right? And what does it mean to be a big language? That means that if you're developing systems for such a language, you have a lot of stuff available, right? You have text corpora, you have text-to-speech libraries. There's people that are willing to put in the work because there you get the return of investment, right? You get a system that allows you to connect to more users. But there's a greater economic value to do this localization in this language. Then you have small languages. So we have, for example, Frisian, right? The second language in the Netherlands, which has a few hundred thousand speakers. But there's also Bambara, which is the largest native language in Mali, which has roughly 3 million speakers. So this is relatively small, but still it's sort of worth looking at it in a secondary phase, right? So for Bambara, for example, if you look on the web, there's lots of pages. The Wikipedia in Bambara is quite significant. There's some reason why you might want to connect to these people. So that's quite interesting. But then the vast majority of languages are very small. right, have less than 1,000 speakers. So that's very extreme. But for example, the second language that we have been looking at with our application in Mali is Bomu, which has only 30,000 speakers. So that's really small. You can imagine that it's really, there's very few people that want to put in the time and effort to make a text-to-speech system or to make a speech recognition for Bomu, because, you know, you don't get that much return on the investment. So for example, we did, in 2012, we downloaded the entire web that was written in Bomu, and this was 24 pages, right? So there's like 19 Wikipedia pages, two church pages, and then some other stuff that was written in Bomu. So that's 24 pages. You cannot do any machine learning of it, right? Or any natural language processing. So that is very difficult to build systems in that language. So that's how, and some of these people that we're talking to, really, their first language is Bomu, the one that they're comfortable in speaking. So that's a problem. How do you do that? Right. So you have a look at the videos that are in the assignment, but what we've been building is this Radio Marché. You've read the paper from Nana, in which we built three systems, including the Radio Marché one, which was the goal here was to improve the access to and the sale of specific products that were in the end good for the this regreening, right? So remember the first lecture, remember the video that I showed in the first lecture where we talk about this regreening. If you use or promote these products, you're promoting the regreening, right? So that was the idea. So can we build a system that allows people to connect to more buyers for their produce? Right? And there was already an existing system, which was a sort of printed out pieces of paper, and then it would be read out on the local radio about how many liters of honey there was for sale and how much it would cost. Right, so what we did is we essentially built a system which had these local market information data, and then you could access this through the web. Right? So you just add and retrieve information. So that's a very simple web system. But then we also had this system that used these text-to-speech and that you can then call. Right. So this is the audio thing. And then some of these radios that did not have internet connection could call in directly to the system and retrieve information about the local market prices, and then in that way connect to buyers. Right, so the video explains this in a little bit more detail. Right, you can implement this in all kinds of systems. We have this office route that we built, right, which is basically a sort of a phone that you can hook up to your laptop. And you put a bunch of SIM cards in here, and then you can develop your own voice servers. We have also more cloud-based solutions that were housed on big server somewhere. And what we have now, and that's what you're going to work towards in assignment 2, is that we also have this, let's say, completely downscaled to very simple hardware. So more about that later. And for the assignment 1, you're using one of those cloud-based services. So not this one, because it doesn't exist anymore, but this Immersion, so the Foxio Evolution that is explained in the Okay, but back to the audio, right? So we actually had this text-to-speech system in three different languages. So one, we did one in Mali and French. So this is sort of French with Malian dialect. And even there, in French, there we have, of course, nice text-to-speech systems. But even there, based on the user research that we did, it was very clear that we needed to have pre-recorded phrases, because the people were only accepting information that was from known voices, according to the people that we asked. So we actually built three systems in French, which have different radio hosts, and each radio used their own voice. And then we also had the same in Barbara, right? Small language, and in Bomu, this very small language. So how did we build it? Well, I have a very simple text-to-speech system. So I'm not sure how many of you have ever done a course about text-to-speech or natural language processing, but this is really a non-sophisticated solution, right? So rather than having a complete language model and doing full text-to-speech, what we here did is this, what's called salt and filler text-to-speech, where you basically, you have some sentence that you want to build, and for each element, you just get a small WAV file from some repository, and you all stick them together, and then you shoot it out. It's roughly what you get in the train stations, right? When they're saying this train is delayed by this many minutes, and it goes from X to Y. So this doesn't work for any type of sentence that you want to say. It only works if you have a very small delimited domain. If you have only a few type of things that you want to say. For example, at the train station, but also here, where we knew exactly the type of things that we want to say. There's this much stuff for this price for sale at this this person, right? So we can have a limited amount of language items and then connect them in a limited amount of ways. But for specific services, this is often fine, right? So we don't understand all of Bamboo, we don't understand all of Bambara, but we can build systems that work. And then these generated audio files were inserted in voice XML files, which is where they could be interpreted by a voice browser and used. And that's also what you're going to do in assignment one, right? So here you can use these pre-recorded voices in your assignment. Okay, so this video I'm not going to show, but I'm going to quickly show you how that works. And I'm just going to figure out where my browser is. All right, so this is still an online version of the tool that we built a long time ago. It's just here now for demonstration purposes, so it doesn't have all the features. But for example, here it says that there's this vendor, Andia Kalakolio, and he sells shea butter, which is one of the products that we looked at. He sells 50 kilos for 1,000 francs per unit. And then actually there's another thing that's for sale, and it would all be combined in one big audio message. And I haven't thought about how I'm going to play this, so I'm going to try playing it back through the thing. Please note if you can actually hear this. Okay, so you can't understand it, neither can I, because none of us speak Bambara probably. Right, but this is the thing that was connected to each other, and sometimes it might sound weird, but we sort of asked the users, is this understandable? And then in some cases where we thought, oh, this is way too fast, they said, no, this is actually fine. This is the way that these things are pronounced, right? So you need to do a lot of back and forth, those kind of things. All right, so I'm, this is Nana, the PhD student who worked on this project here in at TFU. He's actually demonstrating an early prototype, so you can have a look there. But I want to stop now also because in the interest of time. So just sort of as a take home, we looked briefly at HCI for development as a research field. So again, I think it's very important to also let you know how research and practice connect here. How it's related to doing HCI for different user groups that might be culturally different, which has a completely different use outside of international development, but is very closely related. And then we looked at specifically at this low literacy challenge, which is one that we're going to focus on a bit more for the remainder of the course, especially now with assignment one. And there, I think the main takeaway is that there's all kinds of subtleties that you need to be aware of. And those include types of literacy, levels of literacy, your user groups with might have different levels. You can use different modalities together or not. So that's all, you have to, and of course you can't do all that research yourself because you can't be talking to the people out there all the time, but you can ask us or Francis maybe make some assumptions about who your users are. The final thing that I would normally do in this lecture is to go more in detail about how to build voice applications and how to do that for assignment one. But I refer you now to the videos, which are in assignment one. Okay, and now I have two more Mentimeters for you, and I'm not sure if this one is the best way of doing this, but I wanted you to enter your group. Oh no, I had a different one, sorry. So I think we should probably skip this because this one didn't work. So I'm gonna skip this. Yes, and we'll go back. Yeah. So sorry about that. One thing that I wanted to do is to give you an opportunity to put your group number and your use case in the chat. So probably I'll leave this open, and rather than going to Mentimeter, maybe you can just enter your group number and your case number in the chat. So we have a little bit of an idea of what the spread is over the different use cases. So if you could do that now, it would be great. So you can here see the different options. And of course, if your group has already shown up, you don't have to do it twice unless you disagree. I'll leave the slide open for a minute or two. So I think there's already quite a good spread for the first four cases, so that's nice. So there's a bunch of Meteo people. Okay. Just to jump a bit ahead to the next thing. So I think the next thing for you is to watch the voice XML videos, which are linked in the assignment one module that prepares you to develop the application. You can play a little bit around with making an account on Foxio Evolution and sort of trying your Hello World examples. And then if you want, there's on Wednesday during the practical session, Francis can help you out, but he will send more information on Canvas about how this will be arranged. Yes, and Omer has some questions about evolution. So like I said, the video should give you more. I have actually a walkthrough video where I do this live. So I hope that gives you more information. And then I think it's about, you know, building your application from very simple and then extending it more difficult. But if it's not clear, on Wednesday, you have more support from Francis on that. Okay. So I think we close here. Yes, and have a look at the preparations for lecture 4, which is done by Anna. It's about social context. I think you already recorded some videos for that. So we'll let you know exactly what is needed to prepare. But have a look at Canvas for that. Right, and then this was the... I now already had the Q&A up here, but... if you go to if you open your Mentimeter application, you should see some Q&A that you can fill out if you have questions about this lecture or about the course in general. So I'll leave this open and please add any questions. And if you don't have any questions, then we stop here. Slightly longer than I hoped, but also not insanely long. So I think it's 70 minutes, we're more or less done. Thanks a lot. Like I said in the beginning, we are sort of mixing pre-recorded lectures and live lectures. I really want to keep some of the live lectures online. Some of these lectures, so that we keep sort of some level of contact. And I kind of like the Mentimeter thing, even though not all of it worked perfectly, but more for that next time. So for the hardware lecture that I'll do in lecture 5, I'll do also some pre-recorded stuff online, and we keep these meetings so that you don't get lost completely. Astrid, that's a good question. I didn't publish these slides yet because I didn't want to spoil my trick questions. So I'll publish them directly after this. Then we hope to see you on Wednesday and Thursday. Thanks for joining. Get some fresh air and stay safe, and I'll see you all on Wednesday. Thanks a lot. Oh, I have one question that I'll answer. Yes. Yeah, it's a question regarding assignment one, what you've done before Wednesday. I think it's good if you try to sort of set up an account and try your first Hello World. It's probably also good if you try to set up your communication within the group and how you want to organize that, right? That's the one thing that we don't support or force specific solutions. So, you know, try to get the group together, decide on what you want to do, and then figure out how you're going to do the development, what works for your group. It completely depends on everybody's home situation and the screens that are there and connectivity. That's that. And I think the important thing is that you have at least tried a bit the evolution to see if it works. And then if you don't, so this is important, I think, if you're fine, right? Everything works. You're not needed at lab sessions. Lab sessions are really support sessions, and this actually goes for all the lab sessions. So we'll post the material for the lab session. Is all there. If you are already done, your assignment one is finished, then we're not going to keep notes on who's there. Good question. I'm going to mark this as answered. All right. If there are more questions, you can always send us an email. Francis is now also on Canva, so he can also be reached. If there are no more questions, then I'll see you all on Wednesday or Thursday. Thanks a lot. Thanks for the support, and we'll see you again soon. Bye.